Welcome back. Today we're going to talk about problem five, which is a problem which will help you create more advanced financial statements for a merchandising entity. So, in this problem, not only will you be creating financial statements, you will also be performing some ratio analysis. So, let's get started. As always, prior to starting this problem, you should have downloaded both the directions and the Excel file from Canvas. And as you're working through this, don't forget to complete all the requirements and, of course, seek out help if you need it. So, the objectives of problem five are to prepare basic financial statements for a merchandising firm, to be able to compute basic ratios to assess a company's performance. And just like on the last problem, I expect you to cell reference as much as possible so that if a change is made in the data section of a company, all the other data will update on its own. To be able to alter the worksheet to rearrange the order of the financial statements, and of course, as always, to be able to create a chart. So once again, as we're working our way through the accounting cycle, what we will be doing today will focus on two different areas of the accounting cycle that are highlighted here. The first one is to be able to prepare a set of financial statements for a merchandising entity, and the second step that we'll be focusing on is the ability to interpret information. So, I wanted to refresh your memory, and this slide will look familiar. We used it in the last problem. I wanted to refresh your memory on what a multi-step income statement does. A multiple step or classified income statement divides accounts up into appropriate categories to make the financial analysis of companies easier. This means there are subtotals within groups on the financial statement. And the classification and order of information does depend on the type of business and the expected use of the statement. Again, as we noted in the last problem slide, cost of goods sold is an important component for all merchandisers. And again, this is a review. It's computed as the beginning inventory, plus the net delivered cost of purchases, less the ending inventory. In the last problem, we had a very basic company, and it was not necessary for you to compute the net delivered cost of purchases. In this problem, you will be required to compute that. So let's take a look at that in more detail. The net delivered cost of purchases is calculated by taking the purchases account, adding in any freight costs, which you do have in this problem, and subtracting out any contra purchases account. And it looks like in this problem we have both the returns and allowances and the discounts. That's how you come up with the net delivered cost of purchases. So once again, as a review, the cost of goods sold, which must be shown on your income statement in detail, will include the beginning inventory added to the net delivered cost of purchases. That's going to give you a subtotal called cost of goods available for sale. You'll back out the ending inventory to derive the cost of goods sold, which is a major expense line item on a classified or multi-step income statement. So if you're weak on the basic accounting for that, I suggest you back up the video and review those slides again. So here is just a general overview of what an income statement will look like. You'll notice that the title of this is Partial Income Statement, and that's because the cost of goods sold calculation has been removed. I expect you to show the cost of goods calculation in detail. Notice the notation on the slide. I had to get rid of that calculation on this slide just to fit everything in. The operating expenses will be classified into selling and general and administrative. The selling expenses are those expenses directly related to the selling process. Anything else by definition will be shown down here in the G&A or general and administrative expense category. And of course, the bottom line on any income statement is either going to be net income or net loss. The statement of owner's equity is the same exact statement that you did in Accounting 100. I would encourage you, though, to put dollar signs on the first line in each column and at the bottom. In Accounting 100, we don't spend much time talking about little issues like that on the format side. That's why this slide does not include it. But I do expect at this level now, you will be able to pay attention to these formatting issues. So a statement of owner's equity basically shows what happened to the owner's account over a period of time. And as with any owner, we like to see a net increase. In this case, this made-up company called Whiteside Antiques, the owner, Bill Whiteside, was able to increase his net worth from $61,000 to $84,000. We would call that a good month or a good year, excuse me. And again, the slide is designed just to remind you of what is expected to be on a financial statement. That number eventually gets transferred over to the balance sheet. So the balance sheet, we will be doing what's called a classified balance sheet, which once again takes the assets and classifies it into two basic categories. Current assets, which are assets that are realized within 1 year's time, and then plant assets, which are assets that are held longer than 1 year. So just a little refresher on your memory. When we show the current assets, they are shown in order of liquidity, which means the ones at the top are those that are quickly converted into cash. So in this case, you'll see cash, notes receivable, accounts receivable, and then don't forget the contra account is shown as a deduction from accounts receivable. So in this case, accounts receivable totaled $32,000. The allowance is shown right below it, and the difference between the two is what we call net realizable value. The plant and equipment category is the other category of assets that we use for long-term assets, and one important part of that is the plant and equipment section. Here, you'll show the cost, you'll show the accumulated depreciation. There should be an equal sign. I'm not sure why this slide omitted that, but the book value is required to be shown either on the face of the financial statement or in the notes section. So once again, for your plant assets, make sure you show three things on the face of the balance sheet: the cost, the accumulated depreciation, and the net book value. The liability section is split into two parts: current liabilities and long-term liabilities. Current liabilities are those liabilities that are payable within 1 year's time. And again, make sure you put single lines where things are totaled. It looks like this slide, some of the lines, like for example right here, are either missing or too light for you to see on the slide. So I'm providing these slides just as a refresher as to what you covered in Accounting 100. And current liabilities is a subtotal on a classified balance sheet. Long-term liabilities are those liabilities that are not due within the next fiscal year. And they include things like mortgages, notes payable, and loans payable. And so the major part of this problem will deal with creating the financial statements. I'll come back to the ratios momentarily. Let's pull the Excel spreadsheet up. So here you see the Excel file that's been downloaded from the Canvas website. And you'll notice that the data section is in alphabetical order, which generally is of no help to accountants. We like to see things in chart of account order, but on this problem, they put the accounts in alphabetical order. So your job, as described in the handout, will be to fill in the answer section here if at all possible, using cell references. So the titles may be typed in if you need to, but I expect that all of the numerical values will be entered. So, for example, to start us off, it says sales less two things will get me down to net sales. Well, if you remember from Accounting 100, there were two contra sales accounts that you learned about that whose purpose was to bring down the value of the sales. So think a minute. Can you remember what those two contra accounts were? The first one actually doesn't matter what order you put them in. The two accounts were the sales discounts and the sales returns and allowances. So for title A, I'm going to put an equal sign in, and then I'm going to scroll up in alphabetical order to those two accounts. One was sales discounts, so I'll click on it. And the other one was sales returns and allowances. So again, I press the equal sign to tell the computer that a formula is coming. I'm going to scroll up to the answer section in alphabetical order and grab the sales returns and allowances account and press enter. And that will put those accounts in. Then I'm going to go grab those formulas. So formula one, I'm going to go grab the sales number. So I'm going to scroll up here, find the sales number, and click on the cell that the amount is located in this case E43, and press enter. And then I'll go grab the two contra accounts. The first one was sales discount, so let me go grab that. Sales discounts is located here, right below it in E44. And the sales returns and allowances is located right below that one in E45. Once I put that in, I'm ready to calculate my net sales, which is going to be. I'm going to put this on the screen so you can see the whole thing. Now that I've used the zoom slider down at the bottom right-hand corner so you can see the whole thing, I'm ready to put formula four in, which is equivalent to the sales amount less what I'm putting in is up here on my formula bar, less the sales discount, less the sales returns and allowances. And once I've done that, I'll have my net sales. I want you to notice that everything I'm putting in is cell referenced. In other words, when I show you my formulas by typing in the control and the tilde account, you'll see that everything is cell referenced and I have no numbers in here. That's what I expect to see on yours. So I'm going to hit control tilde again to toggle back to the numbers, and we're ready to calculate cost of goods sold. I'm going to help walk you through that. So here you grab beginning inventory. Remember that these are in alphabetical order, so that's going to be under merchandise inventory beginning. So I'm going to go grab that. Merchandise inventory starts with an M, so that's where I'm headed. And here's my beginning merchandise inventory. I'm going to add in my purchases. So I'm going to go grab that. And I'm going to subtract out from that my contra account. Oh no, actually it's going to be my freight in account. So let me go grab that. I'm going to go grab my freight in. And I'm going to go grab the amount. I'll worry about formatting this properly later with dollar signs and so forth. So there's my freight in account. And the computer calculated for me the delivered cost of purchases. The delivered cost of purchases is just the sum of purchases and freight in. Okay, so I'm going to revise that. As I tell you guys, I don't expect to be perfect, and I'm not going to stop the video when I make a mistake. So the freight in, once again, is just the sum of these two. Take out your purchases discount, And the de net delivered cost of purchases will be comprised of these items right here when you're done. It does not include the beginning merchandise inventory. And if you need help on that, go back to an Accounting 100 textbook or go back and review the slides. Let me repeat that. The delivered cost of purchases is just purchases plus the freight. We're going to subtract out from that the purchases discounts and the purchases returns and allowances. So here's the purchases discounts. Here's the purchases returns and allowances. And so the net delivered cost of purchases will automatically be calculated for you. It's this minus this minus this. And the total merchandise available for sale, you need to adjust. And the total merchandise available for sale will be the beginning inventory plus the net delivered cost of purchases. And it may help you if you actually move this over one cell like that. That may help you visually see what's going on. And so I need to back out my merchandise inventory, the ending merchandise inventory. Let me go grab that. They're in alphabetical order under the merchandise inventory ending here. And the cost of goods sold should be automatically computed for you. It would be the merchandise available for sale less the ending inventory. Okay, Title D is the one account I believe that's on here that you cannot cell reference the title name. And that's because it is a subtotal that you won't find in your chart of accounts. So this is sales less cost of goods sold is gross profit. So I'll go ahead and type that in and I'll calculate that as my net sales minus my cost of goods sold. And that's a good starting point. My gross profit is $278,600. Let me put this on one screen so you can see it. From here on out, your operating expenses are going to be classified into one of two types. The selling expenses are those expenses directly related to the selling process. So I'll give you a hint. The first one of those expenses, which are in alphabetical order, is advertising expense. So if they're directly related to sales, there's four of them. And the rest of them are G&A expenses. You may want to print out the directions and code each one of those line items first. So, for example, when you see an expense on your printed out directions, you might want to write a little SE for selling or a little GA for general and administrative, kind of give yourself a roadmap before you get started. You have check figures. You'll want to calculate your net income. And that net income will automatically transfer over to your statement of owner's equity. When you get down to the balance sheet, remember some of your items have been put in here and others have not been. You need to fill this out with the appropriate items. And of course, the check figure that's given to you in your handout must not only balance to the total assets, but also must balance to the liabilities and equity. Remember, they call it a balance sheet for a reason. So just to emphasize that fact, not only check your check figure on the total assets, but also go make sure that it balances your liabilities and equity out as well. I will probably create a second video to talk a little bit more about the ratio part of this problem. That should be enough to get you started on the first half.